This week, it is all about running wires to and around my outdoor kitchen. First, it was building the deck, then the roof, then the fireplace. Now let's run electrical and sound wiring before progressing even further. This isn't gonna be a straightforward tutorial like my other videos because wiring is gonna be specific to your job and regional codes. However, there are plenty of things from my job that you can incorporate into yours, so I just wanna pass along as many tips and tricks and the methods that I use that seem to work. Of course, with power, you have one spot where everything starts. Then from there, it spiderwebs out and breaks off in multiple legs to all the components. So you need a spot to house main power. Then you need to think about how to break it up and run it all over the place unseen. In a house, it's done through attic and through walls. However, in an open space like this, I don't have those spaces. But what spaces do I have? I have the underside of the deck that can be used for anything low. I have the beam that goes all the way around the top. I have four corner posts that will allow me to connect from the top of the structure to the bottom. Then I also have this huge chimney space that is pretty much a big empty box. If you're gonna be building a structure, I recommend thinking about wiring in the design phase. You can make a list of everything in the structure that needs power and where. Then you can make a separate list of all the assets you have that you can chase wires through. Now you can start putting together a plan on making your routes for the wiring and making sure nothing on your list that needs power is left off. For me, I already had 100 amps of power ran over here on my property. However, if you're trying to run something smaller, check out the video where I show how to run power from a house to somewhere in the yard. 100 amps is way overkill for what I need here. So I had an electrician dial this down to 40 amps instead, which will be plenty. I'll be housing all of the main power on the back side of the space. I mounted a box on the inside of the fireplace chimney and secured it directly to a sheet of fiber cement board. By the way, if you're doing electrical work, Crescent has recently come out with their e-shock bits that protect users up to 1000 volts, which is crazy. Here's an electric fly swatter and the e-shock bit guard. I can hold the end while the tip clearly arcs, but I'm fully protected. Now, anytime I'm working around something electrical, I use this bit, even when there shouldn't be any power on. I just think of it as an extra safety precaution. Now that we have the starting point of power established, now we can break it off and start running the wires to the individual components. A great asset of my structure is the beams that run all around the top. However, if you have more of a traditional framing style, you might have a double top plate instead. Back in the roof framing step, we took the time to punch a hole through each and every rafter, right at the bird's mouth, so that when they were all set on the beam, there was a clear pathway to pass through wires. I ran all the wires for the lights that will end up on the ceiling through this chase. It's a 1¼-inch hole, so it's plenty large for multiple wires. And I will eventually have speakers at each post, so I also ran that wire through here after the electrical wires. A tip when working with a spool is to hang it sideways on something such as a clamp or conduit. This way, as you pull, it's free to spin and feed you more length. For the larger spools, a ladder and conduit works wonderful. Once I ran a continuous line of low voltage wire around the beam, next I could start installing lights where I wanted. The wire to my lights fit perfectly in a groove of the T111, so that's where I stuck them, then stapled them to the inside of a rafter until it met the low voltage line. Now, everywhere there is a light, you can cut and splice them together. A tip for this is to cut both lines together, and that way they're the same length, which will give you a much cleaner looking job in the end. However, remember that all of this is on top of the beam, meaning it won't ever be seen from the ground. Instead of wire nuts, I'm using these splice sleeves and really like them. You strip back your wires, then crimp them onto the connectors. I can't recommend enough the 2-in-1 pliers from Crescent. They quickly turn from pliers to wire strippers by flipping the handle over. I guarantee it's the best $25 you'll ever spend. You can use the cutter on the stripper side to snip the low voltage wire apart from one another, which just makes it easier to pull apart. Another tip, and if you can't tell, I'm trying to pass along as many tips as possible. But another tip is when you're looking at the wire, if it isn't colored like traditional wire where black indicates the hot and white indicates neutral, know that the line with writing on it will always be neutral and the side without writing will be power. Oh, and if you're ever in too tight of quarters where you can't use a hammer the traditional way, utilize the side of the hammer instead. It looks silly, but it works. You'll want to staple the wiring down all along the beam, but if you have a splice, it's best practice to place a staple on either side of it. So the top of the beam is great, of course, but if you need access to the bottom side, say for pendant lighting, then a very long drill bit makes quick work of that. So it's as simple as punching a hole through to create a chase, but then when you daisy chain them together, you can again use the rafter chase. So later on, whenever the flue actually comes in, the flue is the member that connects from the top of the firebox and actually goes up into the chimney. That's gonna be connected in later and cut a hole in there. Everything else is just a big open box. They're gonna be using this big open box as a wire chase to run all of the wiring or as much of it as possible sneakily through the entire outdoor kitchen. Now everything can be routed over to the chimney and ran down to the box. You can drill a hole after the fact, or if you plan ahead, you can leave off a small stone in the stoning stage just above the beam. Oh, another good tip, you can end up with a lot of wires, so to prevent getting to the step of wiring them into the breaker, but not knowing which wire goes to what thing, label them as you go. You can do this by writing what it is on a piece of tape and then sticking it to the end. Okay, so that's one way for wiring around the top and then one option for moving the wiring down. But another way is if you have any posts in your structure. I have four, and while the bottom of mine will have stone on them, the top will be trimmed around. Again, this is where thinking of wiring in the design stage is helpful. Before I added cement board and stone to the post, I made a few modifications to later run lights and wires. I get into light choices in a separate video, but I made a small recess with the router so that my lights won't interfere later. Let's say you don't want any lights though. Maybe you want an outlet. You can do the same thing while everything is open. I attached my lights, then punched a hole in the center all the way through the deck. I can run both lights through the same hole, then just tape off the fixture to keep it pretty until work is done. Then that leads into the next major chase, which is under the deck. At least in my case, since my deck is sitting on piers and up off the ground enough for somebody to get under. All of the wiring that can be ran down the post or around the perimeter of the deck eventually got tied together under here. You can staple it to the bottom side of rafters to keep it up off the ground and looking neat. Okay, so then whenever you're wiring in multiple wires, you can tape together all of the neutrals and then tape together all of the powers. And that way, especially whenever you have multiples, it just keeps things easy. Then in order to create some sort of strain relief for this entire system, you can actually take some electrical tape and tape together the entire top portion. Let me pause real quick and talk about this video's sponsor, which is a portable cooling unit, very aptly named Portacool. I'm not even lying, this is one of my favorite finds, and it's a big deal with me being in Texas and coming into summer. Literally, this is a portable cooling unit that takes water and evaporates it to produce cold air that you can wheel up to any workstation and be more comfortable. You can fill up the belly with hose water, then flip the unit on and be amazed at the drastic temperature difference. Me and my team have been utilizing these during the build to stay comfortable in the heat. But they will remain in the outdoor space to always make sure there is cool moving air within it. These don't mist or spray water, so if you are looking into a cooling solution for your workspace or an outdoor hangout space, then I definitely recommend Portacool. They're energy efficient when AC is impractical, and you simply can't beat having it on wheels to go from area to area, always keeping cold air moving on you. If you want to look into Portacool, then check out the link in the description to find out more information. Now let's cover getting power to other areas of my build, such as the hearth, the log boxes, and the countertop bar top area. These are more specific to my actual build, but I still want to show you because in case you're able to adopt the thinking or mindset and incorporate it into yours. The hearth will eventually have two lights in it, and with me pouring a concrete hearth, it's definitely the easiest route to plan ahead. Since I did, I was able to take those sleeves that come with my light fixtures and attach them in position. I just used some fast-setting DAP DynaGrip. Then I duct taped over the hole so concrete wouldn't get inside during the pour. Now, after concrete was poured, all I had to do was punch a hole through the bottom to route the wires under the deck. Easy. For the log boxes, all of their framing easily goes into the chimney framing, which holds the box. So before I poured the concrete countertops, I did the same process as the post boxes, where I routed out a cavity to make sure the light will sit flush. Then also drilled a hole to fish the wire through. The light actually comes off, so I just attached the bracket at this point. Then, once I was ready for lights, I punched a hole through the back of the log box, ran the wiring through it, then punched another hole down to the bottom side of the deck to get tied into the others. Now, the countertop is located on the side of my deck that is incredibly close to the ground and doesn't make it comfortable for somebody to get underneath. So an option here is to run conduit. Not because the type of wiring needs to be in a sleeve, but instead just to give you a way to easily chase wires from one spot to another. One way to chase wire is to tape up the end so the open end doesn't get snagged on something, then shove it on through. Or another method is to use some sort of fishing tape to first run through the pipe. Tie onto the wire you want to feed through and then pull it all. I only had surveyor string on hand, so that's what we ended up using. A trick is to drop in the line on one end of the conduit, then use a shop vac on the other to suck it up. But wait, before you cut your line there, instead, another trick is to now mark that location with a Sharpie and pull through the conduit until that Sharpie mark comes through. Now, at this point, we have an entire length of string through the conduit chase, and then everything from that mark in my hand is another length. So, since we now have double the length, we don't ever have to remove this, and we can just kind of like spaghetti string it through like this and always have a wire to chase through something new. I really hope that makes sense because I think this is an awesome trick. A lot of times when you feed fish tape through, you pull your wire and then you are done. But then if you ever have another line to feed, you have to fish through the tape and then repeat the whole process. By leaving double the amount of string or line in there, you always have a line that you can leave in the conduit for running future wires. When tying such a small string to the line, it might just want to slip through the tape. So a tip here is to double it back onto itself so that it has more of a hold. Then you can put it in on one side and somebody on the other can pull it through.
Wow, I got it. Can you believe it?
I made a slight mistake here. On conduit, you're supposed to put either mail threaded end or some sort of protection around the top end to keep the kind of rough conduit on the top from cutting into the wires. So just note that if you do this, you need to protect the end of the conduit before you feed wires through it. And that single wire was actually just a prop to show you guys an example. We actually needed to run three wires, and that was a bit much for the string to pull on its own. So another tip is to pick up some special lubrication for chasing wires. I used a chip brush to apply some as I was pushing the bundle through, and all Jacob had to do was slightly apply pressure for it to pop right out. With the Romex now by the bar, it can be ran through the studs and all to the electrical boxes, which were put in before the countertops. Then the last two things I want to mention are the ceiling fan wiring and the light above the mantle. These are the only two components of wiring that were ran through the roof. Jacob punched a hole for the ceiling fan wire back in the roofing stage when he was building the Cricut. And the same thing for the wire needed for the light on the fireplace. A few holes punched in the right stage of the build will save you worlds of trouble and give you a much cleaner looking install. If all goes right, you won't see any of it. And with wiring all done, I'm gonna be moving on to the concrete countertops. Whether you're building something large like an outdoor kitchen or something smaller like a shed or a chicken coop, I hope that you are able to at least pick up a few good tips in this wiring video. Stay tuned if you want to see more. Thank you so much for checking out this video. Be sure to also check out my website because I sell lots of useful things, such as these fraction and decimal charts. They're not only cool shop decor, but they're also functional. If you're interested in getting yours, you can click right here.